Slide started. Okay, well, good evening, everybody. It's nice to be talking to you, and I hope that you're going to enjoy the presentation I've got for you this evening. When I was asked to do a talk to the Guild, it was first suggested I might do something about bells in Salisbury Diocese. I could have done that, but it would have involved using a lot of Christopher Dalton's material almost without change, and I probably felt I was a bit short of pictures. Now, I've been doing talks on Bellfounding generally for quite a few years now, but I realised when we were talking about the possible theme for the talk, that I normally deal with the 19th century Bellfounding revival in about three slides, but it is a subject that's worth looking at in a bit more detail. So here we go. What you've got on the screen is a couple of mid-19th century pictures of the Whitechapel foundry, and that's really the basis for where we're going to start. But I'm going to go back a little bit before that, before we get back to the Whitechapel foundry. Okay, so bellfounding is a craft with a very long history. In Salisbury Diocese, there are a number of ancient bells dating from the medieval period. One of the oldest is at Charminster, but it comes from Monkton Deverell. So it actually spans both counties, if you like. And I must admit, I'm thinking more in terms of Wiltshire and Dorset as counties than Salisbury Diocese specifically. And I will be mentioning a few Swindon things later on and places that are actually not in your diocese, but I hope that won't distort things too much. So on the left in this picture, there's a wonderful bell of about 1200, now in a secular building, but originally from a church in Wiltshire. And that's about as far back as bells go in this country, and it certainly is in your diocese. Other bells include ones cast at Salisbury, and the one at Chitton is known to have been cast by a founder called John Barber in about 1400. And in the 14th century, there was a foundry at Shaftesbury, and one of the bells there, the third I think it is, was cast locally in the town and still hangs in the tower at St James's. If we move into the later periods, bellfounding, particularly in the early 17th century, which is sometimes known as the golden age of British bellfounding, there were bellfounders active all over the place. Some of the big firms with a long history in the West Country include the Purdues from the late 16th century through to the early 18th. The Bilby family cast some fine peals, especially in the 18th century, quite a distinctive sound, places like the Back Eight at Beminster, for example. Fine Bilby Peel. They were a couple of the long-lasting firms. And Aldbourne also had a long history of bellfounding right through the late 17th century through until 1826. It started with the cores. The bell at the top is at Lydia Tregoe's, and it's typical of the early work of the cores because it's got sort of ordinary used brass ornaments used as decoration. Very distinctive style of inscriptions and so on. And perhaps better known, the Wells family, who cast a number of complete rings, Robert Wells, James Wells, ending in 1826. There were more local foundries still in the 17th century. This is really proving the point about the Golden Age. Salisbury had a number, John Wallace, John Dorton, the Tozier family in those periods. There was a foundry at Warminster, several members of the Lott family. In the other West Country locations, Lye in Dorset, Montague at Somerset, Closworth, Frome, Bridgewater, and a small foundry at Devizes for a short time in the mid-18th century. Just at one point before we go on, I'm not necessarily going to read everything off these text boxes on the screen. They're more the notes for the talk to save me having to refer to separate papers and so on. So I shall refer to them, but you don't have to read them, and I won't either. And so to about 1840. If you're a church warden in 1840, or a keen ringer wanting to get your bells going again, where would you have gone for help if you had derelict bells like these? Many of the photographs in the talk, of course, are Christopher Dalton's, and this is just such a wonderful, evocative photograph taken before 1974 of the belfry at Cerne Abbas before the bells are restored. Look at that cracked tenor in the, on the left-hand side, all bound up with metal straps. The very antiquated fittings, that wheel doesn't look too true, does it? Not quite apart from general dereliction. And the treble, I think it is almost entirely buried in a pile of twigs. Well, my 50 years of belfry exploration, I've seen a lot of belfries like this. And in the mid 19th century, there were certainly plenty. One of the reasons we've got the rings we have today is because restoration took place at places like this. But where would you turn for help if you're looking to get your bells done in 1840? And the short answer is, it's got to be Mears, more or less. There's several reasons for this. Whitechapel by this state had a complete supremacy in the market. There'd been a decline in the market for bells, slight reduction in interest in change ringing. The 18th century was very strong, the early 19th century less so. But the earlier part of the century had also seen the demise of many of the older family businesses. The Bilby family stopped casting in 1814, although the panels did continue the business to some extent later on. The Penningtons, who were casting from the 16th century right through to 1819, also packed up. The Bridgewater founders, 1826. And Whitechapel had bought up a number of founders that went out of business. John Bryant of Hartford packed up in 1825. Wells of Aldbourne, 1826, Dobson of Downham Market in the 1830s, and the big one, the Ruddles of Gloucester in 1836. So in 1840, the picture was that Whitechapel were very much dominant. Tailors were at Loughborough, newly established there, and also still at Oxford, but still in a relatively small way of business. They were about to get big, but in 1840, they were still quite a small firm. There are a handful of other small founders, as there always had been, but many of the new entrants of the 19th century weren't there yet. They came along later. So this was Whitechapel's golden period, if you like, and their production hit a real high. If you want to look at some figures, these are all the figures in this talk have to be taken with a bit of a pinch of salt. We're not comparing like with like all the way along the line, but these are best available from known bells that either still exist or have existed. And you'll see that Whitechapel basically had an 80% share of the market with their foundries at Whitechapel and at Gloucester, where Thomas Mears had bought up the Ruddles. Tailors were only on about 13% of the market across those 5 years, and the Bristol founders, 3%, and there weren't many others besides that. So when I say that Whitechapel had supremacy, I think the figures back that up and show just quite what a big share of the market they had. Well, in 1840, it was all about to change as the market for bells was to get bigger. This little row of four pictures at the bottom tells the picture that tells the story. First of all, the huge movement in Victorian church restoration was about to start happening. And with church restoration came repairs to bells and improvements. Vast numbers of new churches were built. That's St Mark's Swindon, just a very typical example of the 1840s. A new church needed bells, didn't actually get them until the 20th century, but it's a good example of a new church. The belfry reform movement was to come along later on in the 1870s and 1880s, and the riotous drunken ringers shown in this wonderful 19th century lantern slide were to be reformed and checked out in favour of organisations like the Salisbury Guild. And there was also a big and growing demand for bells for public buildings like Manchester Town Hall. So you can see that what had been a declining market turned into one that was growing considerably. If you look at the work that the Mears and Ruddle foundries had done, they had the Whitechapel foundry goes back, of course, right to the 16th century and before, depending on which historian you believe, as Alan Hughes used to put it. The Ruddles in Gloucester started casting in 1684, but became the big firm of the 18th century, particularly active in the 1720s, but still going strong despite John Ruddle's bankruptcy in 1813, by the time we're looking at, until his death in 1836, when Mears bought the firm out. So Whitechapel, in your part of the world, had cast a number of bells. The first bells in Dorset from Whitechapel were in 1750 and in Wiltshire 1758. Quite par for the course. The same's true in Warwickshire, for example. There are major rings of the period before we're looking at, Wareham, for example, Marlborough. The Ruddles did quite a lot of work in Wiltshire, but less in Dorset. Their only bells in Dorset were the old six at Wimborne St Giles. But they were at work in Wiltshire from 1701 at least, including a couple of eights, Chippenham, for example, the Bradford Avon augmentation 1754, and quite a few big bells. Not all of them survived, but St Thomas Salisbury is still there. They did cast tenors for Bradford in 1703, Westbury 1714. So you have there, as I say, quite a big backlist. If we look at Whitechapel and their own story in the 19th century, towards the end of the period we're looking at, which is really from 1840 to the Great War, Whitechapel was certainly challenged by the arrival of other firms and perhaps eclipsed by some, but they were still strong throughout the period. They were always strong in the southeast, their home market, Kent, Hertfordshire, Essex and so on, Berkshire, but they also had a real stronghold and grip in Lancashire and the northwest, which continued buying Whitechapel bells.
Oh, you've been unmuted.
Am I unmuted? Give me a click to say yes. Charles and George Mears took over after Thomas Mears II retired in 1843, but soon afterwards they ran into a debacle at the Royal Exchange with Lord Grimthorpe, and that did affect their future business. Gloucester finally closed down in 1848, and the lathe, tuning lathe that had been used at Gloucester went on to be used at Whitechapel. One of their great jobs, of course, was Big Ben, recasting Warner's Hour Bell in 1858. But other big bells they cast were one at Great Bell at Montreal twice and Great Peter of York in 1845, since recast. The Mears family continued to run the business until eventually George Mears sold out in 1868. He'd suffered financially as a result of his lawsuit with Grimthorpe, and ended up ruined. He died in poverty in a roughish area of Portsmouth in 1873. But by then, Robert Steinbank had bought up the firm, and he ran it until he died. A.S. Lawson took it on after Steinbank's death, and the Hughes family became involved in 1881. Now, during this period, the Whitechapel foundry especially developed new markets overseas. They were big in Canada and the USA. In the later 19th century, they had about 20% of their business was for the other side of the pond. Throughout this period, the firm remained conservative in outlook in its products. Old style tuning, very old traditional fittings, very slow to follow the innovations that others were later to embark on. If we look at Whitechapel, one interesting thing from your part of the world is that William Kimber, one of the employees at the Oldbourne Foundry, went to Whitechapel as a moulder and spent the rest of his working life there, along with his two sons who followed him in the trade. Kimber was a wonderful artist as well as a skilled moulder, and he did a number of wonderful drawings of bell inscriptions in four volumes, including this little sketch, which comes from the title page of one of them. The catalogues produced by the firm list some of the bells they cast, quite a lot of work in Wiltshire and Dorset. You'll be familiar with some of them, the eight at Chippenham, for example, Bradford Peverell, and the eight at Bishopston, another one. There's one of Mears' innovations, one of their early iron frames from one of their catalogues. That's all I'm going to say about Mears, because they, as I said, they were a constant throughout this period. But what I think, if we're talking about the revival of Bellfounding, it's probably more important to look at some of the others. If we go to Taylors, they were the next biggest company after Mears in 1840, and they grew through the 19th century to become the largest and most innovative firm in the field. Their origins go back to St Neot, where Robert Taylor was apprenticed to a founder called Edward Arnold in 1775. And the business succession went back to the heirs of Kettering. And by imitation, because the early heirs copied their bells from those of Watts of Leicester, back to the Leicester founders who had a long pedigree back from the Wattses in the 1630s. Arnold moved to Leicester in 1784, and Robert Taylor took charge of the St. Neots foundry. And it's 1784 to 1786 that the Taylor story really begins. The first Taylor bell came to light recently. We always thought that 1786 and the ring of Bledsoe were the first bells he cast. But about 5 years ago, a little bell now in the Foundry Museum turned up, dated 1785. So that really is the first Taylor bell. Robert Taylor took the business to Oxford in 1820, and his sons William and John joined the firm. John was a bit of an entrepreneur, developer, very keen on business development, and he took the firm down to Buckland Brewer in Devon, where he worked mainly from 1825 to 1836, filling the void that was left by the demise of a couple of the traditional West Country founders. William remained at Oxford until his death in 1854, but John took the opportunity to move to Loughborough to cast a new pillar of eight for the parish church there, All Saints, in 1840. One of the specifications of the contract was that the bell should be cast in the town. So John rented an old Pickford's warehouse in Loughborough and established a foundry there and was to remain there for nearly 20 years. Business thrived and grew, and by the time he died, John considered himself master of my art as bell founder. He was always an innovator, and he was doing a lot of interesting stuff with tonal developments and shape of bells in the 1850s, and also started making iron and wood and iron frames. There's a marvellous frame of that period at King Weston, down near Somerton and Langport, 1858. Now, John died in 1858, but his son, John William I, built a new foundry in 1859, and that's the basis of where Taylor's are today. A house was added to one side in 1867, and the separate casting hall, which is the casting hall in use now, first opened in 1876. So that site has been in use since 1859. John William the Taylor I greatly developed and expanded the business, and some of the prestige jobs that he landed included the Royal Exchange, Worcester Cathedral, Manchester Town Hall, St. Paul's Cathedral, and so on. But greater things were to come later when his sons John William II and Edmund Denison Taylor joined the firm in the 1870s, led to the technical innovations of the 1890s that I'll talk about in a minute. There was a serious fire at the foundry in 1891, and a lot of the real developments took place after the reconstruction. So here's the Taylor dynasty. John and William, the brothers on the left-hand side, John William the elder, with that rather attractively done. Oh, and incidentally, the picture of John William the first was made by Parlanti, the lost wax artist that they got in to develop their casting techniques, as I'll show you shortly. Many of these people were ringers. John William was the first, rang in the first peal at Loughborough when he was 16. And John William II was a noted ringer, rang a number of peals, conducted a long length, and I believe was in one of the early peals at Exeter Cathedral as well. But the sad thing is that two of John William's sons died in the First World War, and another one died on business in 1927, Arnold Bradley and Price. And Paul Lee Taylor, who was the youngest of the brood, was the son of John William II by his second wife. So he was very, very young compared to the rest of them. And he was the last family member in the business. Edmund Denison was the brother of John William II. Now here's the works from an old engraving, and you'll see that they very proudly boast of their succession from the Watson, Eyre and Arnold of Leicester. There's the foundry as it was, with the new casting hall on the left-hand side, Bellfoundry House in the garden on the right, and the works at that stage with an open yard, it was later covered in, and a little turret on the front of the spire that contained a chime of bells. The 1910 plan is almost recognisable today, though some of the peripheral bits of the foundry on the left-hand side have been lost to redevelopment and in the foreground on the front. The archive contains a lot of super pictures of the works. There's the casting hall on the right, the top left, as you'd expect, and the main hall covered as it was from the early 1890s. The drawing office at the top, top lit so that they could get good light for the drawings. The tuning office, which was a tuning shop, which was added in the 1890s. The workforce, of course, you have a foundry, but no good unless you've got good staff. And the famous Bellfoundry Campanile, added in 1898 with a true harmonic peel of 8 installed in 1899. And there's been more peels rung there than anywhere else. Technological advances included the casting of big bells and also the casting of bells suitable for chimes. The jobs at Worcester Cathedral and Manchester Town Hall particularly led to tailors making substantial improvements in the casting of chime bells, later overtaken by what developments came along in the 1890s. But at the time, it was leading stuff. The Worcester Cathedral job, they learnt the stuff that enabled them to do the bigger job at Manchester. There's Great Abel, cast twice, 1876 and 1882, but an 8-ton hour bell. And this was all during the time when John William Taylor, the first, was in charge. Can't talk about tailors or any other of the 19th century founders without talking about Lord Grimthorpe. I'll call him Grimthorpe, but his name was actually Edmund Beckett Denison, he had three different names. But Grimthorpe was a big lawyer. He was very involved in railways. He was an enormously important horologist from his private interests that became a real expertise. And his book on clocks and watches went to 12 editions. And he really was the expert in that, which is why he was in charge of the clock at Palace of Westminster. He had a very scientific interest in clocks and bells. He was in many ways the expert, but he had theories that were different to usual practice. And if you wanted to get commissions from Grimthorpe, you had to go along with his ideas on thick scale of bells, particular style of tuning. And he was a complete martinet. I mean, tailors befriended him. John William Taylor's son was called Denison after Lord Grimthorpe, but he gave tailors a really rough time. I was reading some of the correspondence recently about the way he ran him wild. Wouldn't pay for a few pounds of extra metal beyond what he Grimthorpe had specified for some of the bells. So they had to toe the line with him, really. But some of the prestigious commissions that went their way included the Great 12 and the Great Ball, the 16-ton bell, until very recently the biggest bell in Britain, cast by tailors, stretched their resources at Loughborough, but very much put the firm firmly on the map. The reconstruction period after the fire led to a number of improvements. This is where John William I was working with his two sons. Bell hanging in frames and fittings, tuning, the tonal quality of bells, bell design, and bells as objects of art. Really, the tailor's products of the 1870s and 80s have been pretty sort of mercenary sort of stuff, really. Sorry, the clock's going to go. Sorry, we don't have a pull-off mechanism in that one. Yes, bells had been pretty workaday artifacts with just the maker's name on very often, J. Taylor and Co. Loughborough, in large chunky writing. And come the 1890s, the appearance of their bells changed enormously. And also the move towards the building of carillons, which was to become a lucrative market. In terms of bell hanging, frames and fittings, the tailors experimented with iron frames in the 1850s, but the standard types of frames that they came to use through much of the 20th century were developed in this period, the 1880s and 1890s. The cast iron A-frames came first. Tall A-frames were the bearings on the crosspiece of the A, like the one in the bottom left. That was followed by H-frames, and originally with wood tops and bottoms, but later with on steels. And then the cast iron low side frames. These very early ones from 1892 are made of interlocking castings, enormously complex to make and very costly. And the idea of using steel and separate castings linked by steel rather than interlocking brought the costs right down. the standard H frame and the standard low side frame that tailors developed in the 1890s have proved the test of time. Hastings stays were another innovation of the period. People don't like them very often, but their great thing is they do reduce friction, and they're pretty maintenance free if they're properly fitted. Improved plane bearings with Haywood lubricators, castle tops they're sometimes called, was another of the developments of the time. They did a number of research and development trips on to the continent, particularly exploring Carolyn's belt quality casting and tuning. But having reread some of these notebooks recently, I think it was much more about decoration and Carolyn's than about tuning at the end of the day. But the big breakthrough for tailors was the development of true harmonic tuning. Canon Simpson had worked out some theories and written about them, but it was tailors who put them to practical effect and worked out physically how to tune a bell, which parts, and altered the shape of the bell in order to produce the required true harmonic with a bell in tune with itself, and also the ability to tune a bell so accurately so that a set of bells could be musically tuned together. On the bottom right-hand side is the set of tuning forks with their resonator boxes that tailors acquired at about that time in the 1890s that are very much part of the story. Bill Hibbert, who's listening, knows all about it and has written a great deal about it. So if you want to know more, his article's the place to go. Look at these bells, beautiful castings. These are actually lost wax castings using the process that Parlanti taught them, but very much following the pattern of some of the things they'd seen on the continent. And this was the standard they wanted to achieve. These are specials. The standard tailored bell still didn't look like this, but nevertheless, the quality of those in terms of the use of lettering, applied decoration and so on, did change rapidly in the 1890s. The one on the left was an experimental bell cast as a trial for a bigger one, but extremely beautifully cast and decorated, apart from the date, which is really crudely applied. It's a bit odd. That was eventually sold on to a Catholic school in Kendal and lost for many years, but came to light recently, and it's now in the museum on loan. But one of the big jobs that they did with the lost wax casting was Loughborough Parish Church. Another replacement peel, 1899, a harmonically tuned set with four of the bells cast with lost wax moulding, and very fine indeed with the artwork. And moving into Carolyn's, the problem with Carolyn's was that this is the sets of at least 23 or more bells cast as a musical and working as a musical instrument. There were a couple of Belgian Carolyn's in the UK, and there's one I'm not mentioning here that I'm saving till later. Aberdeen and Eaton Hall, cast by Van Aerschot of Louvain, but really not considered satisfactory from the musical point of view. Taylors had cast a number of big chimes, and some of the other firms had too. Aberley Hall in Worcestershire, sold on the eve of the Second World War, but had a set of 20 bells with a 4-ton bass bell. But Taylor was very aware of the difficulty of casting, getting the tuning right on smaller bells. And it was the tuning developments that took place that enabled them to really move into the Carolyn world. One of the first true harmonic chimes they produced for Ames in North America, Iowa, is seen here on the floor of the foundry in 1899. And they're now part of a full Carolyn. So the first true harmonic UK Carolyns came out of Taylor's works. They had a model Carolyn installed at the works, and the Carolyn tower you can see on the bottom left was stood on the side of the garden of Bellfoundry House. The plans at the top by local architect Barrowcliffe and Alcock, 1905, and the original bells were installed, 25 bells, two octaves, 1906. It was opened with a recital, there was a recital by Jeff Deneen, the great Belgian Carolineur in 1913. Celebrity recitals. And the Carolyn that did result from this early phase, the first in the UK, was the two-octave Carolyn at Bourneville, later greatly enlarged and largely replaced by Gillett's 30 years later. So what about tailors in Salisbury Diocese? Well, a number of early peels like Blandford and Kingston, White Regis, some of the later ones, it's only the dated entries here that are Simpson tuned, but there's some lovely sixes in Wiltshire where there's some Taylor True Harmonic bells. And in some ways you might say perhaps not that many bells of this period, but you can see that tailors are there. Wimborne St Giles is an important early tailor ring. The next big firm is Warner's. Now, Warner's was established in the 1760s, and they manufactured a huge range of metal goods. They had a brief involvement in Bellfounding in the 1786 to 1821 period, but mainly 1786-1804. And some of those bells were cast at Whitechapel for them. They didn't cast them themselves. And Warner's were not actually really involved in Bellfounding until 1850. But as newcomers, they very quickly landed the job for the big bells of the Palace of Westminster in 1856, casting the first Big Ben, which was 16 tons. That was cast up in Stockton-on-Tees at Norton and brought down, but Grimthorpe cracked it and got Mears to cast the replacement. So anyway, Warner's were a big firm and Bellfounding was only ever a sideline, something that's true of quite a lot of the other firms we're looking at here. But by the 1870s and 1880s, they were possibly the most prolific Bellfounders in the country. They were the first to adopt Grimthorpe's system of using iron case moulds for bell casting, the system that tailors use today. They got the job from Grimthorpe for Doncaster Parish Church in 1858, where a Warner peel was put in the new church, built to replace the one destroyed by fire. In 1878, they lost a number of staff to a rival foundry, which I shall name in a moment, but their output through this time was pretty phenomenal. They did innovate, but generally their work was pretty conservative. They started using iron frames in 1864. St Paul's Wokingham is the earliest. But from the 1890s onwards, they were using cast iron pretty regularly. But after 1910, they had a huge shift towards innovative stuff. And I'll show you some of that in just a moment. Just those last 4 years before the Great War, a lot of things changed. But after the war, they cast a few bells, Mangotsfield 8, now recast as one of them, but then the foundry closed. I've met a couple of family members over the years, and they've just told me, well, they were so wealthy, they just couldn't really be bothered with the factory after the war because of the reconstruction involved. And they kept the business going in name, but actually work went to Mears and Steinbank on a commission basis and later to Taylor's. So Warner's, new on the scene in 1850, really were among the big players of the pre-war era. Here's a couple of their catalogues, and you can see that bells are interspersed with wind pumps and plumbing goods, ball valves, and so on. And just a general range of goods, horse-drawn pumps there. And there's one at the top, which is in the Open Air Museum in Sussex, signed by Warner. Their bells, incidentally, very often have royal arms and patent on the way. They got the patent for using the casting moulds in 1853, and the royal arms resulted either from the House of Parliament Commission, I'm not sure about that, or if not, from the bells they cast for Balmoral in 1856. They moved to a new foundry in Spitalfields. They were originally in Cripplegate, quite close to St Giles. They moved to Spitalfields for a new bell foundry in 1893, just 5 minutes walk from the Whitechapel foundry. So neighbours and enemies, as it were. Their stationery shows some of the other types of bells they cast, and they did a number of big jobs. The Buckfast Abbey original 12 of 1910 was a particularly significant one. They cast a number of important jobs in Dorset. Sherborne Abbey 7th shown there in 1903, and they'd previously cast the tenor as well. And the new ring of bells for Hilberton in 1909. But these are put on to show you the nature of their headstocks and so on, and the fact they were using very old style traditional fittings when everybody else had gone to metal. And they cast bells for a number of different types of churches, schools, cemeteries and everything else, like everyone else. Come 1910, and I think it was when William Nadin, their moulder, retired, they really did change gear. If you go and look at the bells at Somerton, just on the edge of your patch, you'll find a Warner job in a steel frame. I think it's one of their tank frames, and on huge cast iron headstocks. I know when I worked with Arthur Fiddler, I had to do, we replaced the bearings on a couple of these Warner headstocks at Somerton, and they're enormously heavy, much heavier than equivalent headstocks of any other firm. The picture on the top left has very recently cropped up, and I'd never before seen a picture of the Warner's works, but it shows these modern fittings of 1910 onwards, and I think it's probably 1913. I think the bells in the picture may be those from Stoke Climsland, but I need to see a better copy to be sure. But this 1915 advertisement gives an idea of what they're up to. They were working on their cantilever frames with diagonal systems of support for weak towers. They'd introduced self-aligning plane bearings. They're wonderful things, those self-aligning plane bearings. They weren't very successful how they work, but they're certainly ingenious. They were starting to hang bells on aluminium headstocks, lighter bells. The 8 at Felsted in Essex had those. They've fairly recently been replaced. Anti-vandal headstocks for cannon retaining, and renewable gudgeons, which actually a lot of firms used on their old plate gudgeons, but they were using them for cast iron headstocks as well. So all of a sudden, you get a lot of innovation going on. Alan Hughes told me he thought that Warner's at that stage had a fairly laissez-faire attitude, and more or less said, if you've got an idea, try it, and let the workmen get on with it. If you look at these lists of bells by Warner's in Wiltshire and Dorset, actually quite a lot of them have been recast, but the back five at Milton Abbey are still a Warner peal. The six at Bromham are, most of Warminster still are, and the later rings at Hilperton, for example, Wootton Bassett. Bryanston back six, now retuned. The Bridport eight mentioned there have been recast. So Warner's, like a lot of these 19th century founders, their work hasn't had a terribly good survival rate. But this gives you an idea of the extent of their work. And there you have the 1865 Sherborne Abbey tenor, 4600 weight, which was recast in the 1930s. And there at Aldbourne, a very late Warner job in one of their patent steel frames with those anti-vandal headstocks we were just talking about. The next big firm, Gillett and Bland. This was really a clockmaking company, very successful clockmakers and Carolyn machine makers too. Trade under various names, but it was established by William Gillett. Charles Bland joined the company, and A.A. Johnston joined in 1877, which is how it eventually became Gillett and Johnston. They bought their bells from other firms originally to go with their clocks and chimes. And Taylor's correspondence shows that it was always a fraught business working, and Gillett's ended up owing them a lot of money in the 1870s before eventually the Taylor's heard on the grapevine that Gillett's was intended to set up on their own. And there was a very tart sort of almost termination of business letter that left Loughborough. Now, the Bell Foundry was established in 1876, staffed by Henry Boswell, who came from Warner's. And I believe that others from Warner's came too. So they were poached by Gillett and Bland to set up the foundry. Their early bells are very much like Warner's, thick scale with Doncaster heads on, but they started turning out a lot of bells. They became quite a big provider of bells through the 1880s and 90s. And Cyril Johnston started Simpson Tuning 10 years after Taylor's had developed their true harmonic tuning in 1896. Gillett's got off to a slightly slow start with theirs, a lot of experimentation, but of course produced rings like Wimborne Minster at that time. Once that change had taken place and they moved on from the Warner style bells to the Simpsons tuned bells and started with modern hangings, Gillett's reputation and output increased substantially. So there you have Gillett and Johnston, the original founders. The works in Whitehorse Road in Croydon pulled down only quite recently, the last 20 years or so. And initially they were really very fine clockmakers. There's a clock at Tenby in South Wales, 1880, and the chiming machine for Bath Abbey. This is of the Imhoff type, which doesn't require a huge amount of power to lift the lift the hammers, because the hammers are raised and preset. It was a huge advance in chime making. They got going with lots of publicity, these are some of their early catalogues. With views of the works, there's their tuning machine, a bit advanced to the day, ahead of most of the others. And makers of the bells, Wells Cathedral, joke. They claimed Wells Cathedral, always show people Gillett's. Cyril Johnson far more so later on. But the bells that actually cast for Wells Cathedral were a couple of tiny clock bells of about one or 200 weight each. So they weren't slow to milk it as good publicity. Some of their big jobs include the clock bells at the Law Courts in the Strand, 1883, 3.5 ton 10 hour bell, and a Big Brum at Birmingham, about the same sort of weight, 1885. After the development of tuning, Cyril Johnston was in charge of the tuning himself, and there he is with Gillett's early tuning machine, casting tuning the tenor at St. Peter's Croydon, one of their early true harmonic jobs. The fittings of the period, you may say, look a bit like Taylor's. Well, again, Gillett's had some workmen from Taylor's around the period of 1910 and produced clone type fittings. There was a lot of ill feeling between the two firms, always was. So Gillett in Salisbury Diocese, the big job really is Wimborne Minster, 1910. But quite a lot of work in Dorset around that time. The rehang at Wool and some very early Simpson tune bells, 1907, and the other jobs in Dorset at that time. Nothing much in Wiltshire, after the war in both counties, you got rings like Corfe Mullen, Bradford-on-Avon, not long after the war, and more to follow. This is very much work in progress, and I don't want to spend any time on this talk, but the very obvious blue line shows that Whitechapel was pretty constant through the period, but with an overall diminution as the line goes downwards towards the end. Warner's come on the scene and start casting. Something's gone wrong with it, actually, since I last looked at it. I won't spend any more time on it. It's work in progress. Moving on, there are some provincial firms too. Now, Bellfounding outside London had really shrunk to less than 20% of the market by 1840. At the margins, there were always some general founders casting very rough approximations of bells. You know, a bell looks something like this, let's have a go. But we're talking here about the firms that were serious bell founders. And as the century went on, gradually new firms came on the scene as business opportunities increased. These are the major new starts in date order. Bond of Burford had a gap, but they did cast bells in the 1860s and then again from the 1880s onwards, and lasted through until the Second World War. There were three firms in Birmingham, Blues, Barwell and Carr, Carr actually in Smithwick, Shaw of Bradford, Llewellyn's and James of Bristol, T.C. Lewis in London, Moorhomes and McKenzie in Norfolk, and the others listed down below. I'm not going to talk about all of them, but I'm going to show details of just a few of them. You get an idea of their overall volume of work from the list of bells on the right. I think those lists are probably about as complete as they can be. And the W and D column is the numbers of bells for Wiltshire and Dorset. You'll see that not all these firms traded throughout the period, and in fact only two of them were still active in 1939. The asterisk firms certainly did a lot of other stuff besides making bells, and some of them were bell hangers who briefly went into bell founding. So in the Midlands, and there's really not much to say about these, you've got Birmingham, the Blues, Barwell and Carr. Carr's did eventually get into harmonic tuning, but only with moderate success. Blues were eventually taken over by Carr, or Carr's bought the goodwill of the business. They went into it quite seriously and enlisted Grimthorpe and H.D. Ellicombe and other leading people when they first started casting bells in the 1860s. Barwell, good traditional solid work, again they did get into modern stuff like iron frames and iron headstocks, but never cracked true harmonic tuning. The only one at all relevant to your part of the world is blues. Blues cast several heavy tenors, the old tenor at Shoreditch and the current tenor at Brails, which was originally 3100 weight in Warwickshire. That's a particularly fine bell. It's got a reproduced medieval inscription at the top, and blues is Gothic lettering for the rest of the inscription. But they did cast in your part of the world several bells in Trowbridge, one at the church that is now gone, but also the tenor at Trowbridge itself, 2200 weight, didn't last long from 1870 to 1912, but a big enough job to be worth brief noting in passing. Bristol, more significant. There's been a long run of Bristol founders from the 17th century, all interesting, but really minor in terms of mainstream bell founders. The exceptions were the Westcotts, the Wasburghs, Wasburgh and Hale, and William Jeffreys, Jeffreys and Price, who cast Jeffreys and Price included several rings in their output, Glasbury and Kingstown in Bristol, the main ones. But Llewellyns and James were proper bell founders from 1875. They doubled in bell founding before that, but I'm just going to say a little bit about them. They're based in Bristol and did a fair amount of work in Salisbury Diocese. As you can see from this advertisement that I'm not expecting you to read, but it lists all the other things that they did. And bell founding was really just a tiny part of what their factory produced. They had works in Glasgow as well. The works were actually in Bristol on the north side of the Avon, not far from the ruined church of St. Peter. The brass foundry marked in the middle of the map is Llewellyns and James. Dick Bowden has done a couple of lovely articles on the works in the Ringing World if you want to look them up. On the bottom is a fairly typical part of the Llewellyns and James bell, Milton Lilbourne, 1906. With that slopey lettering for the date and a waste inscription with their names on. They were in quite a serious line of business in bell founding from 1875 onwards, and even by 1884 they'd got quite an impressive list of bells on their catalogue. Their earlier bells were like the one in the middle, the colour one in the middle, very traditional. Traditional fittings, and they very often made the mistake of putting new bells in old frames that weren't up to the job, and they got themselves really quite a bad name. But they took on William Adkins Tyler from Taylor's in about 1900, and Tyler introduced Taylor's type cast iron fittings and hollow section cast iron headstocks, and improved the Llewellyns and James hanging product considerably. Tyler, incidentally, was a ringer, came from Peterborough originally, belt hanger on his own, worked for Taylor's, but his real claim to fame is that he was the strapper for the first peal at St. Paul's Cathedral, and he was the grandfather of Albert Tyler, who many older people of Bristol, who many older ringers will remember. Llewellyns and James never really got their bell shape right to produce anything like decent noises. The picture in the middle at the bottom shows that the bells are far too short and wide, and they never really cracked that. They attempted Simpson tuning, but never got there. In Salisbury Guild, and as with Warner's, a lot of the stuff they produced has actually been recast. But they were responsible for augmentations at Milton Abbey at Bradpole, for example. The place in Dorset you will still hear a predominantly Llewellyns and James ring is at Upway. In Wiltshire, and this is where I'm definitely straying into Swindon rather than Salisbury Diocese, Christchurch were augmented by Llewellyns and James to 1881, and the back six St. Mark's are theirs. Their most important commission was Trowbridge, adding trebles, recasting the blues tenor to give Wiltshire its first ring of 10 in 1912. There were also smaller scale local founders, and one of those was Thomas Blackburn of Salisbury. There he is on the left, pictured at Luton, where he became a member of the Sunday Service Band later on. He was born in 1860 in Lincolnshire and died in 1933. But he was active in bell hanging from 1881 to 1905, working with his friend J.R. Jerome of Salisbury, about whom Neil Skelton knows a great deal, and with William Greenleaf, a past master of the colleges and a well-known ringer, briefly for those 3 years before Greenleaf went to set up on his own in Hereford. Blackburn's expedition into bellfounding was fairly short-lived, just 1899 to 1903, when, encouraged by Jerome, he set up the Friary Works in Salisbury and cast a small number of bells. One of them, you can see on the right, it's quite a Mersey-looking sort of bell, one of the trebles at Barclay in Gloucestershire. But Blackburn's frames, very solid cast-iron frames, including the one at Wells Cathedral, and he made one for Canterbury Cathedral as well, were remarkably good. Sadly, the Friary Works failed and went bankrupt in 1903 and had to be sold. And Blackburn spent the rest of his life as a cycle repairer in Luton. I just think in that photograph, he does look so much like Father Jack. Bowell of Ipswich was another small start, rather more successful than Blackburn. Henry Bowell, on the left-hand side at the top, had started bell hanging in the 1880s, and his son Alfred developed the bell founding side. Initially, Henry didn't want Alfred to cast bells because he thought it would result in a falling out with Mears, from whom they'd always bought their bells. But Alf went ahead and in fact cast something like 350 bells over the period we're looking at here. Fred Bell, his son, was the tuner, although in some ways it's thought that he didn't really do much except polish the inside of them. He didn't really know what he was doing in terms of getting harmonic tuning out of a bell. But some of bells are quite respectable. He's not your area, but I wanted to just include it because it's such fabulous photographs of the foundry. There's the works with all the wheels being loaded and bells on a lorry. The furnace, with a man looking out at the top of the galvanised iron tank there, and some of the moulds. The Bowell archive was saved by George Pike, bless him, and is now in the Suffolk Record Office, but it has these lovely photographs in. There are photographs of the jobs too. Cookno, as they call it in Northamptonshire, Alf Bowell on the right-hand side with all his workmen around a new peel of six, and Bell was the master of steelwork. He made his frames and his headstocks out of girders and steel. And his bells actually went remarkably well. He was particularly good at aligning plain bearings, and he got the clappering just spot on. There's quite a few peels of bells over that way. They've been restored, have had modern clappers put in, and have been put on ball bearings, and actually aren't anything like as easy to ring as they were still on Bell's plain bearings. He was a very good hanger. He was also a very competent founder, as the photograph of Lois Whedon shows. Six bells, cannonless castings, 1924. He made good timber frames as well, one for Ashley in Somerset, but my sole justification for mentioning him at all is that he did make a steel frame for Warminster in 1914. The last of the country founders was Bond of Burford. Henry Bond I, and what a fabulous photograph of him top left, getting on a bit by then, but at Upton-on-Severn with his two bells that he was rehanging. They were in a very different league. They weren't the craftsmen that Bowells were, but they did claim descent from the Aldbourne foundry, because Henry Bond Sr., who started as a bell hanger in the 1850s, had bought a lot of his patterns and goods from Bridgman. Bridgman was one of the Wells employees who went to Whitechapel, but then came back to Aldbourne and ended his days there in the 1840s. And Bond was the successor because he bought the patterns and so on. Henry Bond Jr. and Thomas were brothers, though born several years apart. Henry did some time with Blues in Birmingham, and it was when Henry came back to Burford that they got back into casting bells in the 1880s. And Tom Bond cast a number through to the Second World War. There's Tom on the right-hand side, And there are some photographs of the works that I decided not to include because it's not really relevant to your part of the world. But there's some lovely photos of the work showing Bond at work and his very primitive equipment. He was really the end of the line for the small local founder. There were always, right from the 15th century or before, right through to the 20th century, people in general casting who would make bells. They'd have a go, they'd make a few. They're interesting, but perhaps not significant in the real story of bell founding, but they can't be ignored. There were some smaller foundries who were innovators, and one of those was T.C. Lewis, who cast bells for a 10-year period in the 1870s and 80s. Lewis is much better known as an organ builder, a builder of some very fine organs indeed. But for some reason, took to bell founding at this time, and he had particular theories about tuning. He believed that the skin of a bell should not be touched, and therefore he didn't like chipping or machining a bell after casting. He would cast a large number of bells to get a peal of bells, and St Andrew's Well Street is his principal job, peel of eight of 1880, where he had a set of eight with no tuning at all. They were as they came out of the foundry. The whole church and its bells were moved out to Kingsbury in Middlesex in 1932, but the bells are still there. I have seen T.C. Lewis bells that were tuned, so I think the idea that he was completely opposed to tuning is wrong. But the ones at Heathrop in Oxfordshire have been tuned. He used that sort of strange Gothic lettering. His bells are quite Mersey in shape, with Doncaster heads again. But one really interesting thing I discovered was a couple of tuning chiming apparatuses. In the bottom one is at Stowcombe Quay. I knew I'd get that wrong. Near Cambridge, a place near Cambridge with five bells. The top half is actually a different installation at Sawston. And you've got an Ellicombe type chiming apparatus, but he's used organ style connecting rods of wood between the chiming manual and the bells. Quite ingenious. The real innovators were Morehomes and Mackenzie, who decided to take a complete new look at everything, from bell design, using button tops, for example, to the design of frames and fittings. Way ahead of their time. Some of these ideas have been taken up by others in more recent times, but they were engineers, practical ringers and engineers, who decided to set off on a new direction. They cast a couple of sixes that are still going, but they had a disaster at Thorpe near Norwich, where the tower just wasn't up to having that appeal of eight all swinging in one direction, 1300 weight eight. It said they were rung once and the ringers fled the tower in fright. And that really put a stop to their experimentations. And the business, which didn't last very many years, barely 5 years, was bought up by Mears in 1884. There's Captain Moore, a well-known ringer, rang lots of peals, mostly a great deal of them, on the 2400 weight hard-going tenor at Reginald. More innovators, steel bells. Not a lot needs to be said, but from 1855, the traditional bell market did have competition from Naylor Vickers of Sheffield, later Vickers & Co. They cast steel bells and a number of rings, not many left now, Chalford and Wadsden in Buckinghamshire, Chalford, Gloucestershire, are two. The old eight at Moseley went quite recently. But Captain Tom Vickers started casting bells at Sheffield in 1855. There's an 1862 engraving of bells being cast. A lot of people in there, spectators. And at the bottom left is his works with a bell tower in the grounds, the Don Works. In your part of the world, you have a traditional ringer four, steel four at Cannes, what a name for a steel bell, Cannes in Shaftesbury, and the rather strange little five at Tollerwelm, but only two bells in Wiltshire. The 19th century also saw a number of substitutes for bells. You might say steel bells are substitutes for bells, but tubular bells, metal tubes hung vertically and chimed with hammers. and hemispherical bells, which are rather more pleasing in tone. And lastly, some foreign bells. I mentioned earlier that the Van Aerschots cast a couple of big carillons, including Cattistock and, Aberdeen and Eaton Hall. And there was one in Dorset too, installed by the Barnes family and funded locally. 33 bells, two plus octaves, later 35, cast in 1872, and eight of them were hung for ringing. The Van Aerschots were at the time known as the best casters of carillon bells and small bells in particular. And there's Severin Van Aerschot and his son Felix, and a couple of their notepaper heading and their advertisements with awards they'd won for their bells. But Cattistock weren't the only ringing bells cast by the Belgians. Boston Stamp had a carillon, and the eight, including the Van Aerschot tenor, were a ringing peal. The Kilburn eight are still basically a Belgian eight with one recast, and the little light eight, the Lye in Worcestershire, too. Lower Beeding, another ringing eight, 1885, four of them have been recast. So you've got, as well as the carillons, there are several ringing peals that are Belgian. And I end with the founder's great-grandson, who I've been in correspondence with for 40 years and have met a number of times, who we took to see the bells at the Lye in 2010. You can see he's got a big grin on his face, very happy to see them. He's recently cast in his retirement a number of bells of his own. So there you are. That's the overview of the bell-founding industry between 1840 and the Great War. Straying a little bit either side. But I think as a final comment, the organisations and fortunes of the industry are no strangers to change, as I've shown. But the medieval bell founder would recognise what was going on if he went into a foundry today, because bell founding as an art and craft, whatever the changes, minor changes in technical methods, has barely altered over time. It's still about pouring molten metal into the bell-shaped void in a mould. There you are, that's me done.